This is my channel, it's not your channel. I think it's my channel, yes, this is my channel. S-L-A-S-H-E-R-J-P-C. Splatterhouse was released November 23rd, 2010 for Xbox 360 and PS3. The mask, the monsters, the blood, the carnage, and the gore. Fuck my face, man, this game is bloody. Now, this is a series that could be defined as a pioneer for mature content in video games before the ESRB even existed. It's that old, making me feel extremely old in the process. The franchise goes back as far as 1988 in the arcades, and then they brought the sequels out onto the Sega Genesis, and it has amassed a cult following over the years. If you haven't played any of the original side-scrollers, be sure to check them out. They're even included as an added bonus on the disc, so you really have no excuse to try them at this point. Enough about the original games though, let's dig right into what makes this game one of my all-time favorite action games, despite its sometimes glaring issues, because who gives a shit? I love it. This is the story of Rick and his girlfriend Jenny, who are on their way to Dr. West's mansion for an interview, and unfortunately for them, Dr. West turns out to be Dr. Dickhead, who is hell-bent on creating creatures to fuel his insane genius. Rick unfortunately meets his demise, but suddenly hears a voice calling to him. It's the mask, and he puts the mask on, which saves his life in the process, but now he owes it to the mask to do whatever he says, and to ask you help rescue Jenny. To say that the plot is much more advanced than the prior entries is an understatement. Not only do we get to find out why Dr. West is creating these monstrosities in his house, but it ultimately ties into an ancient evil called the Corrupted. And we basically have a full-fledged remake here, and I like the ideas that they threw out. It's pretty cool. There are a few more cool tricks up the game's sleeve with its plot, and while it all still stays fairly simple, it's more than we ever had before in the previous entries. My first experience with Splatterhouse was at some no-name rental store, and I walked in, I saw the cover of it, and I was like, wow, this looks really cool, it looks like Jason Voorhees, and it had some weird ghouls on it, and I was like, yeah, I want to check this out. Little did I know at that age that, man, I was in for a wild, crazy, and somewhat difficult ride. Yes, the Splatterhouse series has always been known for its difficulty, and I'd say this one sticks kinda true to that nature. But I've always loved the series and was always glamoring for another one, and finally, after years of after the announcement, this one came out. Thank goodness. Gameplay consists of what you would expect in any other brawler these days. Special moves, combos to perform, and finishing moves. Rick starts off with a fairly simple assortment of combat techniques, and I'll be the first to admit it, you sort of feel like you're getting your ass kicked in the early moments, because holy shitballs, you're getting your ass kicked in the early moments. This game doesn't fuck around. The fact that they slowly teach you how to play via on-screen prompts on the first level, anyone starting off could maybe be a little off-put by the mechanics or the lack of knowledge with them. And by the end of the first level, you kinda know how to play well, for the most part. Luckily, once you start learning the ropes, learning the mechanics, and fully grasping the combat, things start to get a bit easier. Now, the core element in Splatterhouse is the blood, and there's tons of it. At times, it'll feel like you're just swimming in this stuff. It's everywhere. Ugh. Luckily, blood also serves a gameplay purpose, and it's extremely important. As Rick does battles with enemies, blood continues to explode all over the screen. Now, first off, there's a blood meter underneath your health bar. As you hit enemies, this fills up, and this is how you perform certain special attacks, and as you perform them, well, you lose a chunk of the bar. The most important aspect of all this, though, is your healing ability. Now, most games have regenerative health, and while Rick's character model does indeed take damage and renew itself, which is pretty badass looking, it's not until you actually suck the life from enemies on the screen that you get its benefits. It just doesn't do it automatically, folks. It's a key component to the game, as you always have to carefully ensure you have enough health, can't perform the move, and otherwise, as the mask would say, you're fucked. The other purpose of blood is for leveling up the mask, and by doing so, gaining access to more moves, more health, and more of your blood bar, and there's quite a bit of abilities to unlock, so it should keep you busy for at least an entire playthrough. I can't stress enough how much freaking blood is in this game. It's all over. It's on the walls when you're beating enemies, it's on the screen. I mean, it's just all over the place, and even later in the environments, there's just blood everywhere. In the finishing moves, it's just It's insane. It's probably one of the bloodiest games I've ever played, and yet for some reason it just never really gets me grossed out. It's almost comical in nature, but not. It like borders on copious amounts of extra blood that just seems absolutely ridiculous, yet it just also makes me love beating the shit out of these enemies and replaying this game over and over. I think this is like the third time I've been through it, and it's just always so much fun beating the shit out of these monsters. There are a few segments littered throughout the game that actually recreate and pay homage to the original entries in the series. These sections of the game never last very long, but the side-scrolling moments bring back heavy feelings of nostalgia, and they work rather well aside from a few issues. Like jumping, for example, can feel a bit floaty in these sections. And then there's some other moments where you just can't seem to recover quick enough to avoid another oncoming obstacle, which can lead to frustration. Otherwise, these were a nice nod to the originals. And when Rick isn't fighting, which isn't very often, he might be finding pictures of Jenny scattered around the house, or old records that Dr. West has left detailing his inner madness and how it all began. A few platforming specific sections pop up throughout the game, and while they can look nice once you know what you're doing, holy shit, expect to die because sometimes you simply have no idea where to progress next. This wouldn't be so bad if the loading screen upon death was simple and quick, but it just might be one of the longest loading screens to grace a video game ever. It really takes that fucking long. I mean, it's cool that they at least give me some repeating animation to watch and grunting noises of enemies, but this really kills progression at times, especially if a certain section of the game is getting difficult, and it sometimes just made me want to put my controller down. And that's never a good thing in a video game. Now, the development for this game was on and off for a while. I believe it was 2007. I could be wrong. I didn't fact check here. But if I'm recalling right, this game was announced fairly early on and then didn't come out until 2010. And actually, the original developers were working on it, got pulled by Namco, and Namco was like, all right, we're going to finish this and actually take over ourselves. So the fact that this game even released is one thing, and I'm actually happy it did, because I've heard of games like this having issues and just getting shit canned. So I'm glad that Splatterhouse came out. It does have a lot of issues, but at the same time, I almost kind of give them a little flack, because I really think the game came out better than it should have any right to have. I mean, with as much problems as they were having, and as long as the development time was for this sort of title, it should be way worse than it is. And it isn't, which I'm glad, but yeah. The visuals here have a somewhat cartoony look, and yet keep with the mature and nasty vibe the game has going for it. The copious amounts of blood never gets old for me, and seeing the finishing moves on the pure black background make it stick out even more so and look so visceral. You visit quite a few locations other than just the mansion, and the visuals seemingly do not disappoint. Yet there are some rough patches overall with frame rate issues at times, and glitches like doing finishing moves, and yet the animations don't completely line up whatsoever. I mean, it's never been a game killer in my eyes, but it's still something that leaves a very big sore spot when playing, and as these issues pop up and throughout the entire game. It's just disappointing. Now, the OST is filled with some appropriate rocking metal tracks that go just right with the theme in the background of this game. I mean, rocking out never seemed more appropriate. Yet, they even have a few licensed tracks from artists thrown in that I think they could have done without. The voice acting for all the characters is rather well done, with Jim Cummings being an outstanding voice for the Mask. Him and Rick have a great relationship throughout the game, and the commentary and jokes are more hit than miss. Granted, the repeating phrases in combat over and over can get grating at times. If you couldn't tell, I have a lot of love for Splatterhouse, a lot, but I also have a lot of issues with it, and it is by no means a perfect game at all. Not that any game is perfect, but come on, like there is just some things like the glitches that you've experienced, and towards the later half of the game it seems to get extremely tough and just downright nerve-wracking, and don't get me started again on that loading time. Ugh, the first time I ever saw that, my mouth just straight up dropped, like, are you shitting me? I even installed this game to the hard drive. Are you shitting me? Yeah, it's just really bad. And I know that probably a lot of these issues are due to its rough development cycle. So I can't say I give it a pass because of that, but I'm a little bit more understanding of why the issues are in this game and why it's a little rough around the edges, or pretty rough around the edges at times. At one minute I'm playing and it seems just everything's lining up right, next minute I'm getting some frame rate issues, I'm hearing some sound cut out, I can't figure out where the hell I'm going on these platforming sections, and then I die and it's loading and I just get frustrated. I'm like, damn it, Splatterhouse. Because I love this game. I absolutely love the carnage, the visualness, the horror atmosphere. It's like a horror beat-em-up game, and I just love it. And like I said, it's like my third time playing it. It's just fun. But man, does it have a lot of issues. But even so, I highly recommend it. You can probably find it for $10, $20 probably at the most now. And if you like beat 'em up action games and you like bloody, carnagey, good stuff, Splatterhouse doesn't disappoint. And again, remember, it's got the original three Genesis, or Neo Geo, oh, wait a minute, let me correct myself. The arcade version of Splatterhouse, and then Splatterhouse 2 and 3 from the Genesis versions. It's got all three of those on there that you unlock as you play the game. That makes the game, I think, worth it alone. You basically have four titles, and I shit you not, go try and play those games. They're pretty tough. But you should, because it's gaming history right there, and it's a franchise I love. Will we ever see another Splatterhouse? I very seriously doubt it. But I appreciate what we got, even though it might not have been the best thing. Well, excuse me now, I gotta go pummel the shit out of more monsters. Till next time, guys, follow me on Twitter to see what latest, greatest things I'm doing, which isn't really anything that great at all. And yeah, put the mask on. Put the mask on. Take the blood. Become Rick. That was really corny. And yeah, I'm done. Bye, guys.